It's my honor to introduce our next speaker to talk about when more is less. Please welcome Dave Skuodas, Mile High's Director of Design, Construction, and Maintenance.
Thank you, Kirsten. All right. Well, last summer, my family and I went on the trip of a lifetime, Mediterranean cruise. And one of our stops was at a place called the Cinque Terre. There are five villages like this that cling to the mountainside, and this one is called Monarola. And I took this picture. Bellissimo, very nice. But what the picture doesn't show is that on this particular day, my wife and daughter and I were ready to kill each other. Ready to kill each other. We crammed too much into our trip, and we're making ourselves miserable as a result. And everything came to a head right here. It was very hot, very crowded. We got yelled at for trying to use a restroom and a coffee shop. And then from the cruise ship, we had to take a ferry boat and then a bus and then a train to get here. And then from here, we had to get on a shuttle bus, and it took us up a windy mountain road to get to a second village. And it was along that second shuttle bus ride that my daughter got carsick all over herself, all over my wife. I'm sitting across the aisle with survivor's guilt because I was outside the blast radius and I'm getting dirty looks. It was just, and this was after a series of other long days where we crammed too much in, and we ended every day just sweaty, sunburned, and super dehydrated. This was not a good environment for our relationships. We're okay, don't worry, we're fine, everything's fine. But our working environment sometimes reminds me of the day I took this picture. You know, so we have good intentions, but we are overflowing in an environment of too much. Some of it self-inflicted. You know, that pull towards more data than we could ever meaningfully use. More meetings, more email, more process, more regulation, more technology, more examples that I could keep bringing up. I'll stop there. But we're busier than ever. But does it feel like we're being less productive? Well, all this busyness is coupled with workforce shortages. You know, per ASCE, there are not enough civil engineering students to fill the gaps. Contractors have been feeling this for the past 15 years. We've had an unprecedented run of low interest rates, which created private demand to build more. And then the infrastructure bill added $1.2 trillion more on the public side. And this math is not in our favor. And it's putting all this pressure on us to do more with less, right? Our favorite phrase. We keep trying to cram more in, but in the process, we're losing something, resulting in the wrong kind of less. We're exchanging busyness over substance, convenience over human connection, and process over judgment. And so I've been feeling this tension, and it led me to do some research about behavioral science and our relationship with technology. And here are a few of the great books I've been reading lately, if anybody's looking for a new book to pick up. But it was Subtract was the book that spurred this presentation. And at its core, the book is about our reluctance to have less, to stop doing things, and to simplify, because we gravitate to more. In this simple experiment, people were tasked with making this graph symmetrical. Over 90% of people add blocks rather than subtract blocks. We flow to the path of least resistance, and more is usually more convenient, at least in the short term, in this age of abundance we live in. I mean, it's in my closet, it's more convenient to buy new hangers than it is to go through and find what clothes I need to get rid of. We buy new terabytes of storage rather than erase old electronic files. And of course, we're guilty of adding at the district. We literally doubled our staff and our budget, creating the expectation for more. And even with double our staff, everybody feels like they're hair on fire busy. We're all so busy. How did we end up finding so much work for ourselves? And where was it before? Where was it? So I did some reading. I also did some listening. I asked several people from around the industry, private, public, designers, builders. I asked, what do you wish people in our industry would stop doing, would do less of, or simplify? Where are the self-inflicted wounds where we're making it needlessly harder to produce results? It's gotten harder in a lot of really unfun ways. But technology came up a lot in my research. And Neil Postman, great author, he talks about how technological change is not additive, it's ecological. A new medium does not add something, it changes everything. And he uses the analogy of the glass of water into which we place a single drop of red dye. And we don't end up with clear water and this distinct globule of dye bobbing around. Every water molecule gets tinted red. Well, what technologies have changed our ecosystem? Well, digital communication has been very convenient. You know, we drive less, but we communicate more. Oh boy, sometimes we spend more time communicating about the work than we spend doing the work. And digital communication is very impersonal and it can make us lazy or impatient. My daughter is sure impatient. When she calls her grandparents and they don't pick up on the first try, what does she do? She calls again until I see her doing it and make her stop. And when we send someone a chat message, we get a little disappointed when they don't read it immediately because it tells us if they read it or not. And then digital is impersonal. And make sure you got the sound on for this part here. Look, I'm happy not to drive to every meeting, but virtual meetings make it harder to establish and build relationships, and they're bad for conflict. That's why this video went viral. Oh, I was just kidding. I didn't really mean to act like I was gonna bite your face off. I was just kidding. No, I wasn't kidding. That's right, it's on. I was just kidding. Yeah, digital communication makes it awfully easy for us to be unpleasant to one another, just like that gate. And being face-to-face makes us more cooperative. It's kind of magical. And I'm not saying we should go back to having every meeting in person, but I think we do need to see each other more often. I kind of like you guys. And at the district, we have large staff meetings on Tuesday mornings, and we want to switch these to in-person only when we have an office to go to again very soon. And, you know, if you got a sick kid, plumber at the house, just stay home and take care of that. You can just read the meeting notes later. We don't have to be everywhere all at once. Just let it go. It's going to be okay. And then digital can make us lazy. We send a magical email. Maybe we even use that exclamation point, and hey, it's in your inbox. I know it. I sent it. A local floodplain administrator had a situation where someone else in the city needed an expedited review, but didn't tell her. They just submitted it through the normal portal. Well, of course, when the rush didn't happen, this other person complained up their own chain of command and then three levels above the floodplain administrator and then back down. And many emails were sent. And in the end, it could have been handled by a five-minute phone call because it was an easy enough issue. It just could have been signed off on with a simple phone call. So we need to talk to each other. And then data. In a data-driven world, we get pushed to do more all the time. And data can be super useful, but there is a constant tension around what we could measure versus what's valuable to measure. And this comes up for us with maintenance work. You know, a lot of maintenance work involves chainsaws and trash bags. Should we geolocate every piece of trash we pick up? Now we could try, but is anyone asking for that? Please, nobody ask for that. That would be a lot of time, very time consuming. But I'm told that 15 years ago, we tried tracking everything in Cartograph, generated all this data, but then didn't know what to do with it. It wasn't answering a question anyone was asking. So there is endless novelty we can spin our wheels on, but what will help us do our jobs and won't just create busyness? And then the same thing comes up with engineering tools. Is Drew Beck in here? All right, Drew Beck told me a funny story. He said he had an old boss that would say that engineers are the only people who measure with a micrometer, mark things in the field with a piece of chalk, and then cut them with a chainsaw. Love that quote. I had to write that down. I was like, tell it to me again. Let me write it. Yeah. So digital precision can be very, very useful, but we need to ground things in reality. The folks from Merrick were designing fish passage for our Reynolds Landing project on the South Platte River. And we had very specific velocity requirements. They went to the pain of coding individual rocks into the terrain model, and then they ran various flow conditions in the CFD model. And this is great on screen, but can we actually build it? Okay, that's an important question. In this case, yes, because we're using it to inform a performance spec with a range of rock sizes and embedment depth and spacing. We can do that. That translates to the field. But if they'd have put spot elevations on every one of these little rocks and expected the contractor to build it exactly like the picture, Probably not so much. And then technology makes it easy to complicate things. Oh, I didn't show you that picture. Sorry, there's the terrain model. Okay. And then technology makes it easy to complicate things. And it can produce a false sense of certainty and precision. And just take 2D modeling. You know, these simulations are so cool. They look real, but we can create as dense of a grid mesh as we want. And the hydrology is still only within a 30% plus or minus confidence interval, right? And don't get me wrong, these models are super useful, but they don't solve all our problems, and they create some interesting questions that Brooke has the fun of figuring out in a regulatory ecosystem built for 1D modeling. Later today, Jen and Teresa are going to talk about living hydrology models, which have been very useful in a particular context, but they are more work, and they introduce new questions that don't have easy answers either. So another technical approach that changes the ecosystem. Another common theme from my research was the issue of cooperativeness. Many syllables there. And a contractor I spoke with summarized this really well. He said he comes across way too many people with the attitude that if it's not directly benefiting me, I don't care how hard it is on you. Does this resonate with anybody else in here? This is your chance to raise your hand. You guys all left me hanging earlier. Does this resonate? Okay, thank you. Like I'm the only one running out of steam. You guys are killing me. All right. And he told me about a large project with a lot of submittals. And he put together this elaborate submittal package and sent it to the engineer. It was returned a week later with a blanket statement to revise and resubmit. The problem: product selections on the various cut sheets on the PDF were highlighted in red. Engineer's comment was that red was reserved for the engineer. And if that doesn't make you mad, that should. So now this whole slew of contractors and suppliers get to click on every little PDF highlight and change the color. Folks, we don't have time for stuff like that, and I don't care if it said it in the specs. We need to value teamwork and productivity and have less attachment to perfection or rules for rules' sake, because sometimes an inch matters and sometimes it doesn't. It matters on an ADA ramp. Just ask a contractor who's had to tear one out. It matters on the crest of a drop structure, not so much on an embankment outside of the floodplain like you're gonna see in Andy's presentation later. And engineers, we can use a color besides red to comment if it speeds things up. I know we can do it. And there's this theory called priming. It's this idea that exposure to a stimulus may influence a subsequent stimulus. And a funny example I experienced was when I did a few of those goofy, muddy obstacle courses called the Tough Mudder. And they start these events in waves. And as you're waiting at the starting line, they make you repeat the Tough Mudder pledge, a little bit of priming. So you raise your hand, say, "I understand that Tough Mudder is not a race, but a challenge. All right, folks, speed doesn't matter. Cool down the competitive juices." All right. "I put teamwork and camaraderie before my course time. Again, don't go fast. Don't crawl over people. Nobody cares how fast you go." My favorite here: "I do not whine, kids whine. This thing is 12 miles long with 23 obstacles. It will be hard. Embrace it. I help my fellow mudders complete the course. Again, it's a team sport, so take care of each other. And then lastly, I overcome all fears." Some obstacles are genuinely scary, like you get shocked by electrical wires. So overcoming fear is kind of awesome, so they prime you that way. And see if you can guess which one of my teammates in this photo got shocked in the head and face planted in the mud right at the finish line. And he is still smiling somehow. If you zoom in, you can see all his pearly whites. It's the only white you can see. It's all mud. But here's the thing, this priming had an impact. Everybody was so nice. They took care of each other, helped each other. But imagine if they primed us with the opposite. You know, faster is better. This is an individual sport. Crawl over each other if you must. It'd been chaos. So how do we prime our teams? You know, do we encourage cooperativeness? Or do we push for perfection or rules for rules' sake? We teach them to value moving the work along. You know, as a reviewer, it can be easy to mire ourselves in rules or in principles. And one of my local government counterparts said he often reminds his staff, primes them to keep the big picture in mind and to resist the urge to make stylistic comments that don't matter, because it leads to busy work. And then if someone doesn't address the style comment, do we have to comment again out of principle? Like they didn't address my comment about their font. Come on. No, rejected. You know, more becomes less when we pursue rules for rules' sake, and we need to learn to let it go, because sometimes an inch matters and sometimes it doesn't. Okay, and then business processes are my last topic. And I love this quote from George Patton. He said, "A good plan violently executed now is better than a perfect plan executed next week." So he valued speed and decisiveness over perfection. And he was at war, I get it, we're not at war, all right, fine. But when it comes to our business processes, what values do we honor? You know, hopefully quality and consistency, but do we disregard timeliness and decisiveness? You know, do we use process to distance ourselves from each other or to avoid having to use judgment? So I was struggling to come up with a graphic. Mary, I have a graphic too. Lots of graphics today. I was struggling to come up with a graphic to depict these dynamics, and a lot of you have seen Lane's balance, which depicts the relationship between sediment size and load with slope and flow that leads to aggradation or degradation. Well, this graphic inspired me to create what I've affectionately called Dave's balance. I just had to change two letters. It was like, it was just staring at me in the face. I couldn't help it. There it was. But we've got relationships, process, workforce, and work volume. These factors, these dynamics determine how quickly the work can happen and to a large extent our job satisfaction. When this thing is really out of whack, that's what makes people want to quit and leave the industry. It just builds up over time. We run out of steam. Yes. So if we've got an abundant workforce, maybe it's okay to say yes to every project or to have a lot of process and not worry whether the processes are efficient or not. And then the health of our relationships will always affect our ability to produce results. But when I decrease the workforce and increase the work volume to reflect the current situation, things slow down. Well, can we improve any of these factors? Well, we can't control everything related to work volume, but there are opportunities if we look for them. Now, we have encouraged local governments to send us every development project touching a drainageway, but these projects fall on a wide spectrum from a single outfall to miles of waterway. Now, outfalls matter, but with local governments also reviewing them, is that duplicate review valuable? I mean, we don't have time to duplicate efforts, so we're gonna let go of reviewing smaller scale, lower risk projects. And Bao's gonna talk more about that later. And then how about the number of projects? I investigated our trends for consultant cost as a percentage of construction cost. For construction cost above $2 million, we're consistently in that 10 to 20% range for consultant costs. But below $2 million in construction cost, that percentage kind of goes all over the place, because working in a waterway doesn't get any easier just because the project is smaller. So would it be more efficient where we can to combine projects or perhaps wait to start new projects before some of the other projects are completed? We need to get more to the finish line, because with less of us to go around, we need to lower the work volume where we can. And then process. Process is important for quality, consistency, and organization. But like with my closet, we need to go through and see if there are any old clothes we need to get rid of every now and then. You know, how do our processes impact our designers and builders who are all short-staffed? Do we have enough reviewers to do things the way we've always done them? You know, where could we live with less? Well, with master plans, we traditionally used a one-size-fits-all scope of work regardless of watershed. Well, we found that newly developing watersheds don't benefit from detailed conceptual designs because they don't end up getting used. Fully developed watersheds do benefit from the conceptual designs because of all the constraints. So we're looking to right-size the study scopes of work so we can be more productive. And then with design projects, consultants get asked to spend way too much time sifting through conflicting review comments. Deb and Jerry are going to discuss the cost implications in their talk later, But sometimes we rely too much on PDF comments flying back and forth because it's convenient, and instead we need to sit down with each other more often. So we can have as much process as we want, but it kills our productivity if we blindly apply the same process without any thought about context, or if we use process to avoid talking to each other. Because this is a people business, whether we embrace it or not. And now that we're past the pandemic, we need to reset, reinvest in our relationships because they're the key factor that allows us to make projects happen. Healthy relationships lead to trust. With high levels of trust, things go faster and they're less expensive. With low levels of trust, things take longer and they cost more. I stole that from that book called The Speed of Trust. In a trusting environment, people are empowered to use judgment, and this was one of the most frequent comments I heard in my research, was that people aren't empowered to use judgment anymore. And folks, if we're not empowered as professionals to use judgment, eventually we're gonna get replaced by AI. Let's prevent that from happening. Okay, so in conclusion, we keep trying to cram in more, but in the process, we're losing something. We're exchanging busyness over substance, convenience over humanity, and process over judgment. It's human nature to add, but with the workforce issues we're experiencing, we need to find opportunities to get to less. Now, as I close, I couldn't help but do something super cheesy. Forgive me, I thought of it and I couldn't resist, okay? So when the music starts, the 30-minute morning break will begin. Okay, so as I close, please remember that when we're tempted to collect data that's not useful, to prolong a process, to avoid talking to each other, or to duplicate effort, we need to learn to
let it go, let it go. When I rise like the break of dawn, let it go, let it go. That perfect girl is gone.
You can get up, it's break. Go ahead. You don't have to wait for the end.
Bother me anyway.